टुडे आवर टॉपिक ऑफ डिस्कशन इज COPD, क्रॉनिक ऑब्स्ट्रक्टिव पल्मोनरी डिजीज. वी विल सी हाउ द केसेस अपेयर विद द प्रेजेंटेशन इन एंड व्हाट थिंग्स वी आर रिक्वायर्ड टू नो अबाउट COPD, स्पेशली रिगार्डिंग सॉल्विंग द मल्टीपल चॉइस क्वेश्चंस. So we see case 1, a 72-year-old woman with a history of COPD and arthritis presents to emergency with difficult breathing. So this patient is 72 years old woman and she has history of COPD and arthritis, presents to emergency with difficult breathing. Her caregiver tells you she is feverish, breathing harder than normal and coughing up much more sputum, which has turned thick and green. Your management should consist of, so in COPD, in what we do, we should be, the events following here should be ABCs: oxygen bronchodilators, systemic steroids and antibiotics. What we do in acute exacerbation of COPD, because the exacerbations in COPD can be triggered by a range of factors such as viral, bacterial or infections, the environmental irritants. So exacerbations are indicated by an increase in coughing and sputum production from the baseline, sputum purulence, wheezing, chest tightness and fevers may also be present. Investigations, what we have in investigations, we should do CBC, serum chemistries, in ABGs if severe, ECG, chest x-ray, blood sputum and cultures. So after investigations, the management should consist of an assessment of ABCs, airway, breathing, circulation, supplemental oxygen, bronchodilators by nebulizer, for example salbutamol or ipratropium, systemic corticosteroids, antibiotics if indicated when purulent sputum or elevated WBCs and fevers are there. So in the management of COPD exacerbation, so ABCs, oxygen bronchodilators and systemic steroids and antibiotics are needed. Question number 2, a 52-year-old female with a 60-pack-year history of cigarette smoking. So in COPD, the major risk factor is cigarette smoking, and known COPD presents with a 1-week history of increased purulent sputum production and shortness of breath on exertion. Which one of the following is true regarding the treatment of this problem? So in this case, antibiotics should be prescribed, because antibiotic use in moderately or severely ill patients with a COPD exacerbation reduces the risk of treatment failure or death and may also help patients with mild exacerbations. Brief courses of systemic corticosteroids shorten the hospital stays and decrease the treatment failure. But studies have not shown a difference between oral and intravenous corticosteroids. Inhaled corticosteroids are not helpful in the management of acute exacerbation. And levobuterol and albuterol have similar benefits and adverse effects. And acetylcysteine, that is a mucolytic agent, has not been shown to be helpful for routine treatment of COPD exacerbations. So antibiotics should be prescribed. Question number 3, a 73-year-old white male has severe COPD manifested by repeating hospital admission, 30-step dyspnea on exertion, asthenia and a resting oxygen saturation of 54 mmHg. Which of the following intervention is most likely shown positive effect in his survival? So the question is about positive effect of survival. So the thing that is helpful in survival is oxygen supplementation, because the patients afflicted with severe COPD with evidence by an FEV1 of 1 or less or oxygen saturation of 55 or less, only supplemental oxygen has been shown to positively affect the survival, reduces dyspnea scores and reduce pulmonary artery pressure. The other choices, beta agonist and inhaled corticosteroids, especially when used in combination, are associated with a low rate of exacerbations, but they don't have any effect on mortality. Finally, there is no compelling study showing any impact on survival with pulsed antibiotic therapy. So the thing that is directly related with survival is oxygen supplementation. Question number 4, which one of the following is recommended in the treatment of all four stages of COPD from mild through very severe? The question is asking that in all stages of COPD, what medication is common that we prescribed in every stage of COPD? So the thing that we prescribe is short-acting inhaled beta agonist such as albuterol as needed for dyspnea, because short-acting bronchodilator such as albuterol and ipratropium are recommended on as needed basis for treatment of breathlessness in stage 1, that is mild COPD, and they are also recommended for as needed use in stage 2 moderate, stage 3 severe and stage 4 very severe COPD. So mucolytics can be considered for stage 3 and 4, and inhaled corticosteroids are recommended for stages 3 and 4. Long acting bronchodilators such as salmeterol are recommended for 2, 3 and 4. But these short-acting inhaled beta agonists are recommended in all four stages of COPD. Now, question number 5. An 83-year-old male has a long history of COPD. His resting oxygen saturation is 86 on room air. Treatment includes oral bronchodilator, inhaled corticosteroids, inhaled beta agonists, inhaled anticholinergics, and home oxygen. Which one of his treatments has been shown to prolong survival in cases such as this? So again, this is home oxygen. Treatment of hypoxemia is critical in the management of COPD, and they have shown reduction in mortality with the use of oxygen for 15 or more hours daily. So inhaled beta adrenergic agonist and anticholinergic agonist either alone or in combination provide the symptomatic relief, but it has nothing to do with prolongation of survival. Theophylline can be used for symptoms inadequately relieved by bronchodilators, and inhaled corticosteroids do not appear to alter the rate of decline in lung function in COPD, means the rate that is already declined or declining. Inhaled corticosteroids cannot prevent or change that. However, some evidence shows that these agents alleviate symptoms and reduce the disease exacerbations. So pulmonary rehab improves quality of life and reduces hospitalization, and the thing which has direct effect is home oxygen. Question number 6, which one of the following is most effective in showing lung function decline in COPD? Now they are asking that which thing is important in lung function decline in COPD. So it is basically smoking cessation, because it is the most important risk factor in development of COPD. So that in patients with COPD, smoking cessation has been shown to slow the decline of lung functions and even improve lung functions. So basically it is the first line treatment and the first thing which is beneficial in the cases of COPD, that there should be smoking cessation. Which of the following is most effective in limiting the complications of COPD? So what thing is important in limiting the complications of COPD? So it is again smoking cessation, the thing that stops the decline of lung function and also that limit the complications of COPD is both smoking cessation. Now, question number 8, a 58-year-old male who was diagnosed with COPD 10 years ago came to you because of acute exacerbation that presented with significant shortness of breath and productive cough. He has tried to quit smoking in the past unsuccessfully. The patient is managed appropriately and recovers well. Which of the following measures would most improve survival of this patient? So the thing that improves survival we have discussed already before. It is oxygen supplementation and smoking cessation. So COPD is the leading cause of hospital admissions in various countries. And the patients typically have symptoms of chronic bronchitis and emphysema. So, only smoking cessation and oxygen supplementation have been proven to improve survival in COPD patients because ipratropium and smoking cessation is not correct because ipratropium bromide has been shown to improve symptoms and produce acute improvement of FEV1 in COPD, but it has not been shown to improve survival. Similarly, corticosteroids are useful in the treatment of COPD symptoms flare up as they reduce airway inflammation, but they have not shown to improve survival. Salmeterol and corticosteroid treatment also did not show improved survival, and tiotropium treatment and oxygen supplementation would not be the best to improve survival in this patient. Only oxygen supplementation and smoking cessation have been proven to improve survival. Now, a 56-year-old patient presents with polycythemia. He is found to have low oxygen saturation, increased red blood cell mass, normal plasma volume, and increased erythropoietin levels. Which of the following is the most likely diagnosis? So the thing here is the patient has polycythemia with low oxygen saturation, increased red cell mass, and increased erythropoietin levels. So the best option here is COPD, because chronic obstructive pulmonary disease is persistent obstruction of the airways occurring with emphysema, chronic bronchitis, or both disorders. In the earlier stages of COPD, what happens is oxygen levels in the blood may be decreased, but carbon dioxide levels are normal. But in the later stages, carbon dioxide levels increase and the oxygen level falls. So when there is oxygen level detected by our body that it's less, so it stimulates the bone marrow to send more red blood cells into the bloodstream, and a condition known as secondary polycythemia. So here the best option is COPD, because in the later stages carbon dioxide level increases and oxygen level fall, and it stimulates the bone marrow and even erythropoietin levels are increased, so that there will be more production of blood and so that there can be more oxygen saturation. So, thank you.